Confederates, they're going up against are concealed. You can see them. The men who've repulsed O'Neill have turned around, changed their front, and now they're facing west.
And then we march along the road behind Seminary Ridge. You can see them coming in on the connector to the left. They come in on the right flank. So you first position on the first day.
This is Doubleday's worst fear. Because Doubleday saw this high ground up here.
This small rise that we're topping now, it's a gentle slope down towards, and then once again back up towards Baxter's position up here on Oak Ridge, directly ahead of us. And it's behind that wall that there are roughly 1,200 muskets lying in wait.
Well, you know, another point here is that when you walk this ground, unless you walk this ground, you can't appreciate the subtleties of the terrain here. If you stand back there at the Peace Memorial and look out, it looks like a relatively flat field. But as you've noticed, as we've walked across this field, at several points, Iverson's men completely lose the position they're going to attack from view. They can't see it. But now, they're completely in view. The Union soldiers, you can imagine these men gripping their rifles, their hands clammy and sweaty, their hearts pounding and beating, because they're waiting. They're waiting for the Confederates to get very close. And this is another point that's typical of tactics at Gettysburg, is that infantry commanders allow opposing lines to get very close before they're going to fire. I mean, they've got a rifled musket. They can engage the other guy at about 200 to 300 yards, but they're not going to.
It's the concentration of your firepower, and has to do with the tactics anyway. The single shot rifle musket. An individual is a pretty powerful person with that musket, but to combine it against the opposing line, you have to keep a tight rank, tight formation, concentrating that firepower. And soften one good solid volley, maybe, will make the enemy turn.
Right.
And I think that's what's really important here.
Yeah, that can make the difference. Well, they're getting closer. The stone wall is just up here. All about 150 yards away from us. Union soldiers lying down behind it. There was a thin belt of small trees and some small woods over here along the stone wall to their left.
And over here to the right is Cutler's brigade. They're hidden in the, are they on the edge of the trees or are they back in the woods?
They're gonna move up to the edge of the trees to fire across Iverson's front. The 12th Massachusetts is going to move up to shoot right down Iverson's flank. And now, just about this point that we're standing on the field, right about here, the Union soldiers, the defenders up in front of us, are gonna rise up, level their rifles, and fire a volley into Iverson's men. And that volley, at this point, is going to stop Iverson's line.
Stop it cold. And some of the Union accounts state that there's an audible groan from Iverson's men as they fall nearly in perfect ranks.
Well, he has 103 men killed.
Initially right away.
He has a brigade of about 1,500 men. There's 103 men killed. There's a Confederate officer who rides into this area on the night of July the 1st after the fighting. And he said he counted all these bodies. And I forget his exact number that he counted, but he said it was 90 some that he saw. So some of the dead may have been men who died of their wounds later on. But he sees 90 some bodies. And every body, he said, was lying on its back, except for two that had fallen face forward. But he says the men lying on their backs, you could see the straight line of the brigade by the dead men who lay on the ground. This volley, I mean, the shock of this volley, when it struck these men, the noise, the deafening noise and the smoke, but that shock of that volley, when it struck these men, I'm sure caused every man who didn't get hit to sag and drop down to the ground, because that was their only protection now.
The veterans of the regiments that did survive that all say that they went to ground and hunkered down as low as they could, looking for some sort of protection. They didn't just stop cold, the survivors, they began to fight back as best they could,
right,
loading, firing, passing their muskets up to the men in the front, and trying to return this fire. But the problem here is they're being fired on from two directions. And
right,
then Paul's brigade is going to arrive from the south and add their firepower.
Right.
It becomes like shooting rabbits in a box.
Well, one soldier said it was a merciless storm of fire that came upon them. You've got fire coming down in this direction. So if you're a Southern soldier, you're lying on the ground here, and you have Union soldiers shooting at you this way, Union soldiers shooting at you from this direction, and Union soldiers shooting this way. This field is being swept with bullets. The Southern soldiers, I have no doubt, they don't say this, but I have no doubt that they were using the bodies of their comrades in some instances to protect themselves. It's a natural thing to do. You're trying to live, and you're trying to return the fire as best as you can. The fight lasts a while. Baxter's brigade runs out of ammunition. So it's probably 15 minutes or so.
Good 15 or 20 minutes. One of the officers in the North Carolina regiments out here that says, without a doubt, every man who stood was either killed or wounded.
Yeah.
And only the right flank regiment, the 12th North Carolina under Colonel Davis, is able to get to their right and escape, actually back over this rise and down to a low area where there's some protection. And the problem now is command has completely broken down.
You can't command. I mean, you can't stand up. You can't command. You can't retreat. You can't go forward. You are helpless, completely helpless.
There was
one fellow in the brigade. He said he'd been in every battle that this brigade participated in, all the way to Appomattox Courthouse. And he said it was the only battle he was in where the blood ran like a branch. And that statement is such a stark, horrible statement. You know, he wasn't trying for sensation. He was there. And to imagine all these soldiers who were shot, there's probably 300 or so men wounded, over 100 men dead, men shouting, screaming, bleeding everywhere. It must have been like a nightmare that no one can imagine. Then we've got the Union soldiers. We start to see Southern soldiers pulling anything they've got that's white, waving it, to try to get the Union soldiers to stop firing, because there is no hope. You can't retreat, you can't go forward.
There's nowhere to go.
You have to surrender.
Davis has taken the 12th North Carolina on the other side. He's over there by himself, and there's nowhere for his regiment to go, but he has some protection. And he complains, if not hours, within days after the battle, that he has no orders of anywhere to go. Iverson is back up on Oak Hill watching this attack, and he's very ineffectual, but what can he do? His brigade is being shot to pieces, and he sends word back to Rodes, the division commander, I've had a regiment go over to the other side. He can see through the smoke and the haze the men laying here waving these pieces of handkerchief or any kind of cloth they can get out of their haversacks or their jackets, trying to get this fire stopped.
Right.
And there are three regiments sent out by Baxter to go ahead and round up these prisoners who are now surrendering.
They rush out. They'll rush out right into the midst of the Confederate soldiers. And meanwhile, Rodes has tried to send some troops up to help or support Iverson. So they're firing at these Union soldiers. The Union soldiers are running out, hollering at the Confederates to get up and go to the rear. And the Confederate soldiers are leaving their weapons, leaving their wounded buddies and their dead buddies, and they're running back because they're being fired at by other of Rodes' men. They're trying to get out of this fire and get back over the hill to safety. But essentially, Rodes loses three entire regiments, are gone. Every man is killed, wounded, or taken prisoner. Some of those men, later on in the day, when the Confederates sweep the Union Army from the field, are going to be recaptured in town. But nevertheless, he's going to lose over 700 men out of 1,500.
Out of 1,500, and it all happens within about a span of 20 minutes.
Yeah. To me, what happens to Iverson's brigade symbolizes for the Confederate Army that on the first day they win a victory, but it's a victory that came at a terrific price. A terrible price. And the Union soldiers, whom they overcame eventually, struggled valiantly against them. I mean, this was a desperate battle. The whole fighting on the first day, the whole Battle of Gettysburg, both sides fought with a desperation as if these men really understood what was at stake on this battlefield.
And these men weren't really extraordinary men. 2 years ago, they had been farmers, bookkeepers, clerks, students, every facet of life at that time you can think of. They weren't professional soldiers, only a few were.
Right.
They'd been trained to march, fire, load their musket, and trained to kill. And this is where it really comes down to the dirty, dirty end of what war is all about, is just slaughtering.
Well, you know, I think of a North Carolina boy right here. He's 300, 400 miles away from his home. He's in some place he's never heard of before. You know, we like to glorify this whole thing, the Civil War, the Brothers' War and everything, but when you render it down to this one guy lying on the ground, crumpled up, bullet through his forehead or something like that, far away from home, maybe a letter from his parents or his sweetheart in his haversack or his knapsack, hoping, above all hope, that he's going to come out of this thing alive, and he doesn't. And then that evening, his comrades come back here, and they dig a long trench down through this ground. They drag the bodies, this young man and all of his comrades, and they lay the bodies in the trench, and that's their grave, until the 1870s, when this man, who by that point is completely unknown, is removed from the battlefield. It's not a very glorious death.
And those bodies, these men who had names, had wives, sweethearts, they wind up in another mass grave, another
right.
unknown soldier buried with their comrades. And in this case, these men would wind up in Oakwood Cemetery in Raleigh, North Carolina, marked by a single stone pillar. These are the dead from the battlefield of Gettysburg.
I think of Gettysburg, I think of the grief that this battle spread over this nation is beyond our ability to comprehend it. I mean, we can kind of put our hand around part of it to understand it. When we look at just this one unit, this one collection of men in this gigantic battle and what they suffer.
And we talk about other regiments, like in the morning or the later afternoon fight, the 24th Michigan and the 26th North Carolina would face each other and both take incredible casualties. The 11th North Carolina, the 42nd, the 57th, Pettigrew. But not just these individual units, it's units all up and down the line. Now, many will not suffer the same fate as Iverson, but
right.
in many ways, that company will go in with 40 or 45 men in the morning will come out with only 20. The 16th Maine, which participates in this late afternoon fight, will come out with just a handful of men. The regiment completely vaporized and gone.
Well, there's a letter in a Michigan newspaper that's about 2 weeks after the battle. There were some people from Michigan who came here to investigate the condition of the wounded from Michigan, try to find where men had been buried and so on. And this man writing the article, he said that Farmer Herb's Woods was like a cemetery. There were headstone or wooden cracker boxes marking men's graves. And he wrote a really touching point. He said there was a Lieutenant Dickey and another lieutenant who had been killed, a young men. And he said their parents were there, their fathers. And he said, bitter were the tears that they wept over those men's graves. And that, I mean, that to me summarizes and epitomizes what to Americans in 1863 Gettysburg meant. It wasn't a great victory. It wasn't this terrible defeat. It was an utter disaster for everyone who participated in it. Everybody suffered in some way from the northern reaches of Maine all the way out to Texas.
From a personal level to a national level, it was a victory for the North and a defeat for the South, but it was a tragedy, really, for this country.
Comes into Pennsylvania.
Then, as
the George Schreiber House here
Fiddle's
on Baltimore
Brigade,
Street.
The South, Stone's Brigade, the North, they're staggering and they're falling back to their final position here at the Lutheran Seminary ahead. The 26th North Carolina behind us.